According to compatibilism, if determinism is true, then we can still have free will. And according to incompatibilism, if determinism is true, then we can't have free will. In this video, we'll consider the consequence argument, a popular argument in support of incompatibilism. There are some facts that are not up to me. They are clearly outside of my power or control. I don't have the ability to change whether they are true. For example, I was born in the United States. That's a fact that was never up to me. The Earth revolves around the Sun. That's another fact that was never up to me. And it's important to note that certain things will follow from these facts. For example, it wasn't up to me that I was born in the United States, and it wasn't up to me that being born in the United States makes me a U.S. citizen. So it follows that it wasn't up to me that I was born a U.S. citizen. Now contrast those facts with a different set of facts. Facts that do seem like they're up to me. Facts that seem as though they are in my power. These are things I can freely choose to make happen, or choose not to make happen. For example, I drank coffee this morning. That's a fact that seems like it was up to me. I voted in the last election. That's also a fact that seems like it was up to me. Now, why does all of this matter? Well, according to the philosopher Peter van Inwagen, even though it seems like some facts are up to me, if determinism is true, then those facts aren't actually up to me at all. In fact, if determinism is true, then despite appearances to the contrary, nothing is really up to me. Van Inwagen calls his argument the consequence argument. But before giving the argument, let's review what determinism is. According to determinism, the past state of the world, plus the laws of nature, guarantee only one possible outcome. Think of it this way. According to determinism, if we could somehow rewind time all the way back to the beginning of the universe and then press play, the events of the universe would unfold in exactly the same way as they did before. Dinosaurs would have gone extinct at exactly the same time. The Declaration of Independence still would have been adopted in 1776. Neil Armstrong still would have walked on the moon in 1969. And this morning, I still would have had my coffee. So determinism says that the past plus the laws of nature guarantee exactly one possible outcome. We're now in a position to look at the consequence argument. Premise one says, if determinism is true, then your actions are a consequence of the past and the laws of nature. This premise is true given the definition of determinism. Premise two says, the past and the laws of nature are not up to you. This premise also seems true. What happened in the past and what the laws of nature are not the sort of thing you have power over. Furthermore, what follows from the past and the laws of nature is also not up to you. This leads to premise three. If your actions are a consequence of the past and the laws of nature, and the past and the laws of nature are not up to you, then your actions are not up to you. These premises lead to the conclusion that if determinism is true, your actions are not up to you. This is the consequence argument. If this argument works, and if determinism is true, then it turns out that all of those choices that I thought were up to me were not actually up to me. I thought my drinking coffee this morning was up to me, but the past and the laws of nature guaranteed it would happen, and those weren't up to me, so my drinking coffee wasn't really up to me. It's important to note that this argument is not intended to show that free will is impossible. It's an argument for incompatibilism. It's meant to show that if determinism is true, then we do not have free will. So, if determinism is false, then the consequence argument is of little consequence.